worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior. Totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be trained, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves. Inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore do these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs, deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you.
Hello, friends. And welcome to one of my favorite places, a steep down cliff hillside with a small cave behind us, where I took cover when I went Pindabad many times for the rain. Doesn't look so, but it's more than 50 degrees steep down here. And there's another cave down there. Well, down this path there's another cave, small cave. And here you see it's very nice with uphill, the way the trees cling with tree roots coming down all the way up the stone and cliffs, and hairy roots is falling down. But under here, this small overhang is a good production site. You see, some people have made tea here before, small fireplace. This is a good production site. So you can even be behind the roots here for a new what would you say series.
Hello to you, friends. Here we are in a small, convenient middle cave up to the pass to Cypress Hermitage, which lie in this direction, opposite the small village, Badagala village, which is down in this direction. And then there's a steep hillside down here to the Cardamom Jungle, down towards Huluganga River. Good place to a new episode of What Buddha Said, and also a new episode of the video logs. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, indeed. This is what Buddha said, number 8, and it's the first 5 verses from the Dhammapada, the way of the Dhamma, or the right way, a very popular text of 427 verses said by the Buddha, usually in correspondence to some episode happening in the Sangha and in the society at that particular moment, usually relating to some stories from his own or those persons who were participating in the events, those former lives. It's the second book of the Khuddaka Nikaya. That's of the Tipitaka. It's the first, the Vinaya Pitaka, and last, the Abhidhamma Pitaka, 3 baskets of text. These 2 baskets are not relevant for lay people. But the middle portion containing 5 Nikayas, 5 text collections, where Khuddaka Nikaya is the little finger. This is the second text of the Khuddaka Nikaya, which is a text of the minor collections. And that actually is a book of fairly thin book of 427 poems. I published it on my website in a fresh translation or rendering, and also together with the stories translated by a Burmese and some pictures. I think that was made in Thailand or Malaysia, I'm not sure. But nevertheless, they are all available free on my website, and I give the links below. Burlingame has translated the very voluminous commentary, which is actually in 3 volumes, which is also a very neat reading, and it's also free now on PDF file of my website, and I give the link below here and also in the video description. And all poems says both illustrations and a background story, and I will give the links to the poems, pictures, illustrations, which are very neat, and also I'll show them here while we go through the poems, and also the background stories. I will provide a link under here, scrolling under here, and also in the video description and in the audio descriptions too. The first chapter is called Twin Pairs. They always come in pairs. Yamaka. And the first one is called Origin. Mind always comes first. Mind is of all states the primer. By mentality are all things initiated. By thought of mind are all phenomena formed. So if with good intention one thinks, speaks, or acts, joy and happiness surely follows one like a never departing shadow. However, if with evil intention one think, speaks, or acts, pain and suffering certainly follows one like a wheel follows the ox cart. First is obvious the connection between karma, that any thought, any intentional thought going before any thinking or participating in any thinking, in any speaking and any acting with the body, that forms one's future. This means one's present moment
was caused, created, and conditioned by mind in the past. Past mind. By the karmic response, the karmic echo effect. So any conscious moment that contains intention forms a series of future conscious moments. So one is creating future, not only future per se, but also the content of the future, whether it will be happy or unhappy, whether it will be pain or pleasure, or whether it will be neutral and indifferent. Who is creating? Ignorance and craving is creating. Mind is creating. What is ignorance and craving creating? It's creating suffering. So therefore, the goal of the Buddhist training is to stop this mind, keep pulsing out probability in the form of karma, intentional echoes that will hit one as if from behind, as a wave of probability from behind, unseen, unknown, unperceptible, but folding out in the events one is going through moment by moment, all one's life, before, now, and later, and much later. So cutting this process by stop intending. And that's really difficult because you intend billions of times per second. Before you look this way, before you look that way, before you think this thought, before you think that thought, before you see this, before you agree or disagree in that, then there's intention. Chetana. Chetana. Intention is karma, said the Buddha. Is probability. The same thing. So this intentional content of consciousness creates future moments and their content. By conditioning them, creating them, warping them, influencing them, and creating their emotional, affectionate content, whether it will be pain or pleasure, happiness or sorrow, gladness or sadness. This of becomes, it struck me when I start to read quantum mechanics, then it this mind always comes first, the Buddha say. Pupangama comes first, precedes all phenomena. Mind precedes all phenomena. It became evident when I suddenly read a statement of the American physics grand old man and still guru, I think, for many physicists, young as old, with his it from bit pointing out that the next century we have to work on reformulating physics in the concept of information, which is inherently linked to the knower and the consciousness of knower, and thereby to mind. But nevertheless, he said that no phenomena, no elementary phenomena is a phenomena if it's not observed. If there's no mind that observes the phenomena, then it's not a phenomena. It corresponds to the formulation of quantum mechanics or the interpretation of quantum mechanics, which is called consciousness causes collapse by Eugene Wiener and John von Neumann, which says that when there is some, what quantum mechanics says, there's a wave function out there with probabilities, which is, I think, is basically the same as the probabilities of reforms by karma. Because this would be a natural link between consciousness and probability. And this this wave function of probability is what nature comes with. And then if an observer looks at this nature created probability cloud with a certain in a certain setup and forms a certain setup and asks questions, binary questions, yes, no questions to nature, then this, at the moment of this experimental probing, this wave function collapses, poof, and becomes a particle. Before the particle, then it's very much debated the ontological status, how this particle of matter exists. Bohr, another one of the gurus of early quantum mechanics, deposited that it's in a superposition of all possible states before it's observed. But this is a difficult thing to understand because, for example, if it's a thing that spins this way and that way, can then he says, it's spinning both ways at the same time. But it should not be understood really like that. It has a possibility of being observed, like spinning this way, and it has a possibility of being observed spinning that way. And it has a possibility of being observed in that way. And that's suffering frequencies, percentages, 40, 40, 20, for example, to observe them in that. And if an observer comes and measures, observes intentionally this or similar situation, then he will see four outcome of the one and four outcome rotating this way, four outcome rotating that way, and four outcomes or two outcomes rotating this way. So it is the mind of the observer that makes the wave function collapse and thereby induce the elementary quantum phenomena to have properties such as spin, location, mass, all the properties that the macroscopic world is perceivable by. Before that, they are not perceivable. It's a cloud of probability. So also on the most fundamental level, at you can't come to at all, then it's true, mind comes first. Mind initiates all phenomena. It's mind that collapses the wave function and make the phenomena manifest. What they were before, we have no right to speak of. When we speak of, they say it's a superposition of all possible states. If we try to say that this all possible states exist at the same time, then we come into logical conflicts. So once you stay out of that and say, we have no right to say what it is, where it is. It's basically non-local, everywhere present. What we can say is that when mind looks at it, then one of these properties comes out. If mind looks at it repeatedly, then it fulfills the Schrodinger equation and thereby a nice probability distribution comes out. But nothing can be said about the single phenomenon before it's observed. Another Pascal Jordan, he went even further and say, it's not only do observation disturbs the measurement, they create the measurement. It is we, by observing, by putting up all our equipment, that compel the electron to have a special location. And same thing with John Stuart Bell, a Scottish physicist, which have received a lot of attention recently with his Bell inequalities. He said that the path of an electron only comes into existence when we observe it. So where it is and the path it goes, and if it is something that mind creates by intentionally observing a given phenomenon. So mind really comes first. And therefore this Dhammapada verse 1, it really overarches much more than one initially realized, that I initially realized. It not only does it speak about mind's intentional creating a future and the conditioning of this future's particular properties in the event of a given individuality's travel through this future from this intentional accumulation of past moments. But which is fairly subtle, basically the law of karma and how the law of karma comes about in 8 lines. It also speaks about how matter is observed and how the macroscopic world appears out of this cloud of probability, and that we are participating observers in manifesting this world out there as a kind of projection, a split between the observer, what the observer wants and what nature can project, what has been accumulated in nature by all this collective observation process of many observers, of innumerable minds of observers through an endless time. This is basically what we call nature. So nature and mind is much more connected. Nature is much more mind-like, consciousness-like, that one should initially think because of this effect, as also pointed out before by others. Verse 2, burning with blaming. Those are absorbed in such accusations as he, she, they abused, hurt, did me or us wrong. Whether right or wrong, such foolish ones only prolong their own pain by being obsessed by their own anger. However, those freed of these accusations, he, she, they abused, hurt, or did me or us wrong, noting whether right or wrong, so what? So what? Such clever ones stop own pain and suffering by relinquishing all anger. And this one should think about whenever pointing out others' mistakes, especially if somebody has hurt one or offended one in any way. This Me Too wave that is rolling over by accusation of sexual abuse has come to mind, but all other kinds of also. And I look back at my own accusations now in this split second of numerous beings, both righteously, but unfortunately also unrighteously. What you come to pay by unrighteous accusation is that you will be unrighteously accused. And if it's a noble you have unrighteously accused, then you will be unrighteously accused and incalculable, not infinite, but incalculable, a sankhya number of times. So it hangs into the future. This contacts one have with nobles. One doesn't think they are noble because one is so much in love with oneself and what is much more right and so on. So one ditches them. Also because usually they're very modest. They don't flag it. They don't go around with a big nose, see me, blah, blah. So one falls right into the accident. So one burns oneself on the noble, or one is elevated by a rocket if one treats the noble good. So they are kind of like point-like. One never know where they are. Enhancers of future, good as bad. But they multiply one's karma by asankhya, by an infinite number. So if one gives to them, one is lifted up. If one hurts them, one crashes into a karmic catastrophe. I just like to say that I've written a little bit about this phenomena, about reality and how it comes about when consciousness looks at it. It's called how real is reality, really? And I'll give the article as a PDF on 2 or 3 pages down here with some references. And so you can check it out for yourself. This was worth 3 or 4. The last verse, verse 5. Fuel on fire. Not by anger is hate ever quenched, only by kindness, friendliness, goodwill, metta, love. A love supreme, a love supreme, a love supreme, John Coltrane. Only by kindness is hate always quenched. This ancient law is an eternal truth. We take it again because there's so many wars, so many conflicts, and it's just relevant all over the place, where this anger, this irritation, this opposition, this conflict, this fighting emerge. It's relevant to come back to this one. Fuel on fire? No. Never put fuel on fire. Not by anger is hate ever quenched. No revenge. Doesn't help. Make it even worse. Only by kindness, metta, love, is hate always, 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 and only by that quenched. This ancient law is an eternal truth. Dhammapada, number 5. So imagine you have a big fire and then you put fuel on it. This is revenge. This is backbiting. And then the fire blows up and burns everyone around this fireplace down to the ground. We said about it, if there's fire outside on the workplace or among the friends outside the family or outside the workplace, then don't take it in. Don't take it inside of the house, because the house burns down. So this means that whatever conflict there is in some external regard, that is, once you just bring it home. And whatever conflict there is inside the family, inside the marriage, inside the family relationship, inside the company, we should not bring it out. Don't bring the conflict out. It won't help them out there. And that's really true. Only by kindness, goodwill, and my own focus is friendliness, is this hate, opposition, anger, irritation, always quenched, silenced. You can try yourself if somebody is irritated at you at the queue in the supermarket. This is something I practice regularly. And there I can see they are kind of like, I usually buy a lot of food at one time because I buy for three to six weeks, in one go. So it's a lot of things, a full cart of things. It takes a lot of time to calculate, and even more time because I have to check out with some vouchers I got on paper, and they have to go to another office and come back and so on. So I get a lot of irritated looks at the supermarket queue. It happens almost every time. Nevertheless, so I just take my stance there and smile to them, and then be goodwill towards their heart, from my heart region to their heart region. And then in almost all cases, if I don't have I've not missed one yet, but it can be if they're very hardened, then they will not melt. But usually they will smile and then find another cue. But they, when they leave after having been dissolved in this bath, invisible bath of metta, universal friendliness, may you be happy, may all beings 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 be happy. I love supreme. Then it's difficult to stand there. You can see, so they suddenly melt. It melts away gradually. But John wants you to be specific and directs one's mind to it. Immediately see the situation. Ah, there is opposition. A conflict is boiling. Metta. I love supreme. And by that is what Buddha said, number 8, finished. Almost. Because I need to say thank you to all the Dayakas, donors, and those who support every month and give food and support the meditation hall. And I also need to say thank you for your clever attention, kind consideration, and advantageous contribution. I love supreme. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. Indeed.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pampalela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo. Tasso, Bhagavato, Arahato, Samma Sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.